It's murder.
You like that, right?
Yeah. What up, guys? Your boy Quake. And first off, before we get into this new episode of Who Really Won, I want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart for 100,000 subscribers. This is definitely a milestone. I didn't think I would get here, so I really appreciate it. I had to get that out the way. I want to thank each and every single one of you for constantly watching my videos, liking, sharing, being active on the channel. I really, really appreciate it. And as a thank you, for the first time ever, I got on Twitter and asked you guys, what episode of Who Really Won do you guys want me to do next? This is the first time I gave you guys the chance to vote for the next episode. I gave you guys a whole week on my Twitter to vote. I put the three most requested episodes as options, the first being Jay-Z versus Nas, the second being Tupac versus Biggie, and the third being 50 Cent versus Ja Rule. 309 of you guys voted, and at 43%, 50 Cent versus Ja Rule was the one that won. But don't worry, I will be doing Jay-Z versus Nas in the future, and I will be doing Tupac versus Biggie in the future. Just for right now, we will be focusing on 50 Cent versus Ja Rule. So as you can tell by the video title, this is 50 Cent versus Ja Rule, Who Really Won. Now, this beef is arguably the biggest beef right behind Tupac versus Biggie. This beef was intense. People almost died. There were people that were actually killed. There were a lot of speculations, a lot of different sides to the story. I will explore each and every single side. 95% of this information that's being told in this video can be Googled. You can search all this information up. The other 5%, I ended up talking to a few people that were close to 50 and Ja before they blew up. I talked to some other people, got some information. So that 5%, you will not be able to Google. This is information that I've just gotten from talking to people, because I want my sources to be accurate. I want to make sure I get everyone's side of the story completely as accurate as much as I can. So with that being said, you guys know how we do these episodes. The first thing, we're going to start it off with how the beef started. Then we're going to get into the major points in the beef. Then towards the end, I'm going to give you guys my opinion on who won the battle portion of the beef, which is the short-term portion of the beef, in the midst of the beef, who won. And then I'm going to talk about the war portion of the beef, who won longevity-wise after the beef was done, who prevailed more. So with that being said, grab some popcorn, grab a drink, and enjoy the show.
I'll tell you personally, the Murder, Inc., the people that you see, like Irv, Ja, the people that are involved in the business aspect are bitches. Like, these niggas don't got no hood in them. Yeah. I can't even see how a kid could look at Ja Rule and want to be like, well, this nigga want to be Tupac Shakur. This nigga doing duets, but you call yourself a murderer the whole time. That shit is crazy. I really don't like that guy. I really don't like Ja Rule.
You know what I'm saying? These niggas is faggots, man. You know what I'm saying? Y'all gotta understand what I'm dealing with. When you're dealing with niggas that's not real niggas, you gotta sit back and evaluate the situation. But now that everybody has got a chance to evaluate the situation, see if this nigga 50 is a clown.
But get this, Rule TV. 50, you're on my dick. I done fucked you up once, fucked you up twice, and you're still talking shit. What must I do to get through to you? Put two in your cabbage. I done fucked you up once, fucked you up twice. 50, get off my dick.
Now let's talk about how this beef actually started. There are multiple stories from 50 Cent's side and from Ja Rule's side. First, let's get into who 50 Cent and Ja Rule were in 1999. That's when the beef started, in early 1999. In that year, Ja Rule was clearly a bigger artist than 50 Cent. Ja Rule in 1999 was gearing up to drop his debut studio album, Vini Vidi Vici. He had done songs with The Lox, Jay-Z. He was signed under Def Jam, which was a big label at that time and still is to this day.
It ain't even a question how my dough flows. I'm good to these bad hoes, like my puss sweated. I'm dry like damn clothes, which y'all niggas don't know. It's easy.
And in 1999, 50 Cent was also signed to a label at Columbia Records, but he did not have enough buzz to drop his debut studio album at that time, which was Power of the Dollar.
No heat, it's like a fit with no kick, a fiend with no hit, a willy with no whip, a bad bitch that won't blow dick. It's like a roadie.
So now that you know where they were in 1999, let's talk about 50 Cent's side of the story on how the beef initially started. The way the beef started in 50 Cent's mind was that when Ja Rule ended up getting robbed outside of his house by a guy named Lil Troy from Baisley Projects, 50 Cent says that he knows Lil Troy and ended up hanging out with him at a club named Club Amazura in Queens. And after Ja Rule saw 50 Cent say what's up to Lil Troy, that's when Ja Rule started acting funny towards 50 Cent. In that club, there was a performance with Jay-Z and Ja Rule. They're performing Can I Get A. 50 Cent ended up going backstage and wanting to say what's up to Ja Rule, but Ja Rule was hesitant to say what's up back. And after that situation, 50 Cent felt really disrespected. And ever since then, in his mind, that's when the beef started.
It started off with something that was real small, you know. Like a friend of mine robbed him. A guy that I know from my neighborhood had robbed him, and he seen me saying what's up to the kid.
Oh, wow.
And then he felt like, you know, he didn't want to send it to the kid because he felt like homie ain't got nothing to lose.
Right.
But he said something to me because he felt like we pit.
Right.
You know what I mean? So he, that's how originally it all started.
Got blown out of proportion.
Yeah.
Ja Rule, however, in a recent Vlad TV interview, denies this part of the story. He says that he knows Lil Troy and that Lil Troy was originally his homie from Southside. And Lil Troy just got out of prison, and when he saw Ja Rule walking down the street at night, he decided to pull up on him, got out the car and said, "Let me holler at you." They ended up walking down the street, and then Lil Troy pulled out a gun on him and wanted his chain. And ultimately, why Lil Troy pulled a gun on Ja Rule was that he thought he was having sex with his girl while he was locked up. And Ja Rule said he had nothing to do with that. Regardless of that, Lil Troy ended up robbing Ja Rule of his chain that night because Ja Rule did not have a gun on him to defend himself. So Lil Troy ran away with the chain, and Ja Rule went back to his hood, ended up putting in a phone call to call Kenneth McGriff, aka Supreme, and within a matter of 20-30 minutes, Supreme got his chain back from Lil Troy and said, "It's all good."
A dude that I knew, that I fucked with from Southside, came home from jail, came on my block one night, seen me on my block one night, came to see me, rolled up on me. He was like, "Yo, Jewel, what up? You know, whatever, whatever." They called me Left back then. He was like, "Yo, Left, what up? And me, you know, me holler at you for a minute." I'm like, "Yo, Troy, what up, my nigga?" Jumps out, car, we go, walk up the block, we kicking it. He pulls out the burner on me. So now I'm shocked, you know what I'm saying? Because I know this, like, I know him, I fucks with him. So now I'm shocked. So he pulls up the burner on me. He's like, "Yo, you holding, you strapped?" I'm like, "Nah, I ain't got nothing on me right now." He pat me, whatever, whatever. So he's like, "Yo, you was fucking my girl while I was up north, just that and the third." And I'm like, "Nigga, what are you talking about?" You know what I'm saying? Like, "Nah, I wasn't fucking your girl." You know what I'm saying? And if that was your girl, and I didn't know that that was your girl, that's a different situation. I said, "But if I'd have known that's your girl, nigga, me and you cool." Like, that's what that was about.
Okay.
So he proceeds to say, "Yo, give me your chain." It had nothing to do with music, hip hop, rap, none of that. You understand what I'm saying? So now.
So you gave him the chain?
Of course. I said, "Yeah.
It's a gun in your face.
Nigga, got a gun on you, nigga. The nigga with the gun." You know what I'm saying? It's the winner, nigga.
Yeah.
Hands down. The guy with the gun won. You know what I'm saying? All right, yeah. You got the gun. All right, yeah, nigga. Take that. Hold on to that, nigga. Okay. Not a problem. You know what I'm saying?
All good.
I puts in a call to Black Just and Preem. Like, because that's their little nigga, too. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, "Yo, where's this stupid nigga at?" You know what I'm saying? Like, this nigga just came over here and fucking, you know, so this is how this went down. Preem was like, yo, hold on, let me handle this, you know what I'm saying? Nigga,
it's not a big deal. This nigga's, you know what I'm saying, he's in his feelings or whatever. Let me handle it, boo. Whoops. Before you and your little niggas come over here and act crazy. No problem. Mm-hmm. Preem calls me back 15, 20 minutes later. He's like, yeah, I got the nigga. He's over here right now with me. You know what I'm saying? I got your chain. He just came back on the block. I took your chain from him. I got your chain, nigga.
Right.
And that was that.
For those that don't know, Kenneth McGriff, also known as Supreme in Queens, was a highly respected drug kingpin in the 1980s that formed the team Supreme Team, and they ran all kinds of things in Queens when it came to drugs. They were doing a bunch of drug trafficking, and in 1987, Supreme was arrested following a joint state and federal investigation, and in 1989, he pleaded guilty to engaging in a continuing criminal enterprise. He was sentenced to 12 years incarceration, but Supreme was released from prison on parole in early 1994 after serving approximately 7 years of his sentence. And in 1994, this is when Supreme first met Irv Gotti and Ja Rule. Irv Gotti at the time was shooting the music video for the Cash Money Click song Get the Fortune, which Ja Rule was part of. Supreme ended up showing at the video shoot and ended up asking Irv Gotti, can he shoot a movie for him? Irv Gotti said he barely knows how to shoot a music video. So ever since then, that's when they formed their relationship.
You know, it was all, when he had, the first day he met Irv, that day, that video, Cash Money Click, Get the Fortune, Fuck the Fame, was the first day Irv met Supreme. Mm-hmm. I didn't meet him yet. What did he ask Irv? Can you shoot a movie? First day. He didn't talk no street shit or this and that. He asked, oh, you shooting a video? You know, I'm trying to do a movie. You think you can shoot a movie? That was the first day.
What did Irv say?
No. He said, I barely know how to shoot a video.
Real talk.
Yeah, kept it 100. Yeah. Boom, everything good.
When Supreme got out in 1994, he was no longer selling drugs and was basically broke. So he needed funding to help shoot the movies that he wanted to shoot. He wanted to go legal in business and no longer have to deal with drug trafficking and do things the right way. But unfortunately, like I said, when he got out, he ended up being broke because all the money that he made from drug trafficking was seized. So now that you know the backstory between Supreme and Murder, Inc., Irv Gotti, and Ja Rule, back to early 1999 with 50 Cent's side of the story about Ja Rule getting robbed. And in a Vibe magazine article in July 2006, Supreme was interviewed about the various incidents that he was involved in. And in there, he ended up talking about the incident that 50 Cent says initially sparked the beef. And Supreme says that he knew Lil Troy. He was just a young thug who grew up under the Supreme team who committed the crime of robbing Ja Rule. And Supreme said that, I always see these articles where 50 is saying that his man robbed Ja, but that's my man. I raised him. And ultimately, Supreme got him to return the chain, which coincides with Ja Rule's story. And ultimately, Ja Rule says that he got his chain back and that he didn't care that he saw 50 hanging out with him because that was his friend. So that part of the story doesn't make sense to Ja Rule.
There's no watch involved. So anyway, so I guess the story got back in the hood of what happened. And so 50 used that as his in to have something to say about me. You feel what I'm saying? Okay. But it had nothing to do with him. Like, I didn't even know you know this dude. You know what I'm saying? His story is, I seen him with Troy out and about and I got mad at him. Like, nigga, you had nothing to do with it. Why would I get mad at the guy next to the guy? You understand what I'm saying? Like, his stories just don't add up. They just don't make sense.
So now let's talk about Ja Rule's side of the story on how the beef started. Ja Rule says that around the same time in 1999, they were shooting the music video for Murder for Life, and they shut down the whole Jamaica Ave in Queens, and 50 Cent heard of this and decided to come through and say what's up. And according to Ja Rule and Black Child from Murder, Inc., they said that they just showed quick love to 50, said what's up, and kept it moving. And because they didn't show enough attention to 50 Cent, that's when the beef initially started. 50 felt disrespected, and that's when he recorded the diss track and kept going at them. 50 did confirm this and said that they didn't really say what's up to him, but he says that's because 50 Cent was hanging out with the guy that robbed Ja Rule, which is the incident earlier that 50 Cent mentions that initially started the beef.
It was Murder for Life video shoot. Rule was shooting on Jamaica Ave. We shooting the video, 50 came through the set. I guess he expected us to greet him with open arms. Now me and Ja just hit him with a what's up and kept it moving. And he felt like we didn't show him enough love on the set. And from that point on, you know what I mean, he started hating.
However, there is a third version that a lot of people have discussed on how the beef started between 50 Cent and Ja Rule, and this one is mainly discussed amongst people from Queens. This third version suggests that 50 Cent was jealous that Supreme was supporting Ja Rule and Murder, Inc. instead of himself. When Supreme got arrested in 1987, he was gone for roughly 10 years, and while he was gone, his nephew, Prince, ended up taking over the Supreme team in 1989. And while this was happening in the early 90s, 50 Cent started becoming a teenager and started selling his own drugs and running his own blocks. So ultimately, 50 Cent was coming up under the Supreme team. He looked up to the Supreme team. He looked up to Supreme, to Prince, and idolized what they were doing, and ultimately ended up following their blueprint at that time. 50 Cent highlights this in a September 2006 issue of the XXL magazine with Banks and 50 on the cover. In this article, he talks about Supreme. He responds to the Vibe interview that Supreme gave while he was locked up in July 2006. He responded to that and cleared up a lot of the rumors. This XXL interviewer just happened to get 50 Cent when he had a lot on his mind. The XXL interviewer said they saw him sitting at the G-Unit Manhattan offices, and to the XXL interviewer, it was clear that 50 had a lot on his mind to talk about a lot of things. The interviewer ended up asking, what does it mean to be raised under the Supreme team? 50 responded by saying they came at a time early 80s into the 90s. Everybody that was from that era fell under that umbrella at some point. It wasn't under Preem, it was under Cat, Lorenzo Fat Cat, and Coralie, or somebody down there. You looked up to all of them that rang them kind of bells, because they're doing what you're doing, and they can count so much more to the streets at that time based on their reputation and what they accomplished. I came up under all these guys, not necessarily the Supreme team in Baisley, but everything that was going on in that era. Initially, I didn't know Preem like that. I knew Preem through Black Just. Blackie was cool with me. He was calling me Kurt when everybody was calling me Boo Boo or 50. He financed the boxing program. Blackie, he was that guy to me. He paid for it, but he was under this guy, and this guy was in jail at this time. So what 50 Cent is saying in this is that he really looked up to Black Just, and the fact that Black Just looked out for the community. He ended up opening up a boxing ring where people could go, the youth could go, and box. 50 Cent would attend that. Black Just really liked 50, and the fact that Black Just really respected Supreme, that ultimately ended up making 50 Cent respect Supreme. The article continues, and the interviewer continues to probe at the relationship between 50 Cent and Supreme, and as this goes on, you can tell that 50 Cent sort of felt resentment towards Supreme for deciding to push Irv Gotti and Ja Rule over him. The interviewer says, it seems like Supreme bothers you more than anybody. And 50 responds, yeah, I like him. We're married till death do us part. The interviewer asks, what does that mean? 50 says, I love him more than anybody alive on this planet. We have a special bond. He cannot go to sleep without me on his mind. Then the interviewer is slightly confused and says, but married? That sounds deeper than, and then gets cut off, and then 50 says, listen, they was supposed to fuck with me, the old heads in my hood. Why? Because they know I'm authentic. The interviewer then says, they were supposed to get behind you as a rapper. He says, period. Any move I decided to make, they were supposed to roll with me, because I'm actually from the same fucking cloth. I'm an offspring of them. I'm not a relative. I'm not a brother or sister to these guys. I'm a distant cousin. I'm from down the road. Everything that's fucked up about me comes from these motherfuckers, and that's the behavior. And after reading this, it's clear that 50 Cent has resentment towards Supreme for, like I said, supporting Irv Gotti and Ja Rule and Murder, Inc. 50 Cent sees Murder, Inc. as these fake gangsters that have not really lived that life. 50 says he comes from the same neighborhood, the same cloth as Supreme, has done the same things, has sold drugs, has had violent altercations with people. So he's frustrated that Supreme is supporting these guys who aren't even from the same neighborhood, because Irv Gotti and Ja Rule are from Hollins in Queens, and Supreme and 50 are from Southside in Queens, and Hollins and Queens did not get along at that time. So 50 Cent was ultimately confused as to why Supreme would support these guys.
You know, I could get into the story of how when Irv first met him, he called me because he was like, I don't know what's going to happen, because we're from Hollis, Queens. So all my adolescent life, I was against dudes from Southside. Yeah. It was just the, what's that, Hatfield and McCoy's. You know what I'm saying?
It was just something to do as
if
young
you're from
men.
There, we're from here. It wasn't about I knew you or why we're beefing. We just beefed.
And this is why a lot of people say that this is when the beef initially started, because 50 Cent was frustrated with Supreme and he wanted to prove to Supreme that Murdered Inc. is not the people that they say they are, and he wanted to destroy them as a brand. And if he had to take down Supreme with them, he'll do it at all costs. And he highlights in the XXL article the time when Ja Rule was shooting the Murder for Life video. Supreme was on the video set, and that he went to the video shoot and Ja Rule acted real funny when he saw them. And then 50 went back and went to go get a gun to shoot at Ja Rule, scare them away, but Supreme ultimately ended up stopping him from doing that. 50 Cent says in the article, so I went and got the pistol. I went there on the motorcycle because I wanted to see what it's about. Supreme seen me from across the street walking down there toward the shoot and says, hey, come here. Don't even do it. I see you. He pulls me to the side and I'm like, yo, what's up with this guy? And he's like, nah, I told you. Leave them alone, man. You know they ain't gonna do nothing. Then 50 Cent proceeds to say that whatever same type of shit he has running through him is running through me, and he can't see it enough to give me room to coexist with him. He wanted me to submit, and that's just not in me. A guy would have to kill me to stop me from doing what I want to do. That's what they tried. It's not gonna happen with a halfway mark. You really have to kill me to stop me from doing what I want to do. Because all I believe is what I think. All I believe in is me. My thoughts and the way I see things are my truths. It has to make sense to me, and then I'm with you. So what 50's saying in this is that Supreme saw multiple times that 50 wanted to get at Ja Rule and Irv Gotti, but Supreme ended up stopping him multiple times, and 50 did not want to be controlled by Supreme. He wanted to be his own man and to coexist with Supreme, but Supreme never wanted that. He wanted just to work with Murder Inc. and make sure that they rise to the top. And of course, 50 was not cool with that. He said, I'm gonna be my own man, and you'll have to kill me to try and stop me. And ultimately, he's saying that's what they tried to do, but it never panned out that way. And that's the third reason as to why this beef initially started. There's, of course, 50 side, Ja Rule side, and then what the streets say. And I'm gonna let you guys decide on what you guys want to believe on how the beef started. So after the altercation at the music video shoot for Murder for Life, 50 Cent then went back to his hood and decided to work on his debut studio album, Power of the Dollar. And one of the songs that he recorded was called Your Life's on the Line. And this track was the first track on Wax going at Ja Rule, Irv Gotti, Murder Inc., Supreme, and various other people. People got word of this, that 50 Cent was gearing up to release a song going at Ja Rule and Murder Inc. before the song came out, because 50 would go in his hood and spit some of the verses off the song. A lot of people then started hearing about it. Word started spreading. Ja Rule started hearing about it. Black Child from Murder Inc. started hearing about it. And Black Child said that 50 and him were looking to get a taxi. And when they ran into each other, Black Child said that he heard that he was gearing up to release a diss track towards Ja Rule. And Black Child asked 50, please don't release the diss track. I'm with them over there eating, and I wouldn't really appreciate that if you're trying to mess up my money. 50 then said, hey, I'm not going to do that. And then 3 weeks later, the song came out.
He went back to the hood and, you know, he wrote his song, that Murder, I Don't Believe You. See, the thing is, a lot of people don't know, like Swing, this was this kid Swing from the hood, and he, I guess, you know, when niggas is in the hood and they write a new verse, they spit it for people in the hood. It's a little different now because you got social media, so they might be catching in studio recording. So he was spitting the verses to a few people in the hood, and niggas told me he had a song early before he recorded it. So I ran into him after the Av, we did the video, and I'm like, yo, Swain told me you got a song. If it's a problem, I'm fucking with John Eaton, man. Let's just leave that alone. Let's just get money. That's what level I was on from the gate, you know what I mean? And he was like, nah, I ain't got no song. And then a few weeks later, that Murder, I Don't Believe You came out. So.
And a lot of people don't know this, but there's two versions of the song. The first version was the intended original version. This had lyrics that were directly going at Ja Rule, at Supreme, and everybody else that was connected, including Jay-Z and Nas. So 50 was going at everyone's neck on this version. And the reason why this version never ended up being released on the actual album and being promoted like the one that's out right now is because he was name dropping a lot of people on Columbia Records. Wasn't liking that. They did not want that attention from the streets. They were worried something bad was going to happen. So they asked 50 to change the lyrics, clean it up a little bit more where you're not name dropping and where you're subliminally going at these artists instead. And 50 had to agree in order to get his album released at that time. But the first original version appeared on a Cutmaster C mixtape back in 99. And the full version, which hasn't leaked to the internet, allegedly features Tony Yayo and with an outro of 50 basically cursing out everybody. But that version got out to the streets. Ja Rule heard it. Everyone heard it. So regardless, the retaliation was there. But the clean version, the more, you know, mainstream version, was released on October 12th, 1999.
The way these cats move confuse me, but it's all good. Puff, you ran up on Steve. Why you ain't run up on Shook? I'ma ask these questions because I don't understand. Cheeks, why you ain't show the tie wake? I thought he was your man. Jigga, stay away from Ja before he get on some bullshit. Talk to police on that Sammy the Bullshitty pussy Ja. Why you get juxed in your own hood? Why niggas who rob you walk around like it's all good? Damn. Why you ran the prank to get your shit back? Why you wanna approach me? Cause you know I push the shit back.
Street murder, I don't believe you, murder. Fuck around and leave you, murder. I don't believe you, murder, murder. Your life's on the line.
Ja, when I don't like a nigga, I don't pretend to. I had a paramedic wrapping your fucking head like a Hindu. Yeah. Nah, said he half man, half amazing. You half X, half pop. That ain't hot, nigga. I ain't going nowhere, so get used to me.
After this track was released, it was official that the beef had been started. Now it's on wax, and who knows where it's going to go from here. Then in fall of 1999, 50 Cent and Ja Rule meet up once again in Atlanta outside of a hotel. How 50 Cent and Ja Rule ended up at the same place in Atlanta was that a promoter booked 50 Cent and Ja Rule to perform at the same venue at the same time. Now, Ja Rule and his Murder, Inc. artists were already there at the hotel outside when Chaz Williams, who was 50 Cent's manager at the time, pulled up, saw Ja Rule, and reached out to Ja Rule and said, "Hey, can we talk about this situation that you have with 50 Cent? Is there any way that we can squash it?" Ja Rule said, "That's fine." Then Chaz went back to 50 Cent and asked him the same thing. "Can you talk to Ja Rule and possibly squash this?" And Chaz Williams wasn't on anyone's side in this beef. He's always maintained that he's in the middle. He never sided with 50 or Ja Rule. He just basically tried to end this beef. And Ja Rule and 50 had major respect for Chaz Williams because he was a legend and an OG in Queens. Now, here's where the story gets mixed up once again. There's 50 Cent's side. From his book, From Pieces to Weight, he details the incident at Atlanta. And then there's Ja Rule's side from his book, Unruly, and he details the incident in Atlanta. And they're two totally different stories. Sort of the same situations in the beginning, and then towards the end is where things go different on each side. So let's talk about Ja Rule's side of the story first. Ja Rule, Chris Gotti, who's Irv Gotti's brother, and Black Child, who was signed to Murder, Inc. at the time, all have the same consistent stories on what happened that night. 50 and Ja Rule ended up talking with each other. They ended up walking down a street, just Ja Rule and 50 by themselves. Ja Rule had a bat over his shoulders that he had from the shows that he did previously when he was performing on stage. He said he carried bats and just had random stuff on stage. So he just happened to have a bat with him. It wasn't because of 50 Cent. He just had it around his crew. And that apparently is what set off 50. When they were having a conversation, Ja Rule said that he didn't like that he released the Your Life's on the Line track, and 50 says that he can't take that back. And Ja Rule started getting more and more aggressive in his conversation. He started yelling more and more. 50 then noticed that and didn't allow Ja Rule to use the bat first and hit him. So 50 decided to swing on Ja Rule and hit him first. Chris Gotti and Ja Rule both say that 50 did swing first. Black Child says that he turned his head and didn't see who swung first. But Ja Rule and Chris Gotti confirmed that 50 did swing first. 50 even says that he swung first. That's confirmed on all ends. Even Chaz Williams himself said that 50 swung first. Chris Gotti details that Ja Rule grabbed 50's shirt, pulled it over his head, and that 50 couldn't see where he was. So Ja Rule kept punching him and kept punching him. Then Ja Rule's crew members started joining in on beating 50 Cent up. He said that Black Child joined in. Then O came and picked up the bat and started beating 50 Cent with that. And then the OGs, BJ and Uncle Chaz, which is Chaz Williams, broke it up. Then Ja Rule says that 50 Cent's crew didn't do anything. They ran inside the hotel and got on the elevator. Then Ja Rule got so frustrated that he grabbed an ashtray from outside, threw it at the elevator, and that's when the staff at the hotel called the police, and that's where that ended off that night. He said that don't show up to the concert or you will die, and that night 50 Cent did not end up showing up at the concert.
Atlanta, probably.
Okay.
He's not an artist yet, really. He's trying to get in. This is, and then we see him in Atlanta. We're probably about 20, 25 people. Right there, there's a hotel, Swiss Hotel. I don't think it's the Swiss anymore, but it was right there in Buckhead. And he's with Chaz. Chaz was managing him at the time, Black Hand.
Yep, I know Chaz.
And Chaz was managing him. He sees us, Chaz's family comes over. Yo, I want you guys to fix this. Can we work it out? Boom, boom, boom. Chaz, let's do it, fix it. Ja and 50 walk off talking. You know, Rule got that big voice, you hear him, I don't know you. You know what I'm saying? Why are you making these records? 50 snuffs him.
Okay, so that part's real.
Absolutely. Okay. Vlad, you will never get no lie out of me. It doesn't make sense to lie. If a real is real, that's the bottom line. He snuffs him. You want to hear the real story? Ja took the snuff. Takes him, has his shirt over his head, hitting him right back. He gets out of his shirt and starts running. We're all on the way, because we, you know, once we seen him snuff Ja, we're all going over there. Mm-hmm. He runs into the hotel, boom, 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 gets away.
So what happened was, I see him in Atlanta, you know what I'm saying? A mutual friend of ours named Chaz. He sees me.
Black Hand Chaz.
Black Hand Chaz.
Queen.
Uncle Chaz, yes. He sees me outside of the hotel before 50 rolled up. And he's like, yo, Ja, you know, 50 just want to talk to you about the, you know, whole situation that's going on. Will you talk to him? I was like, Chaz, I ain't got no problem talking to homeboy. You know what I'm saying? When I see him, we'll talk. So he pulls up a little bit later. Now, I had a little bat and some gloves and, you know, that was whatever. So I see him. He pulls up. So we get to talking, you know, and the talk got heated because I got mad and I start screaming at him and telling him that, you know, he was a bitch and this, that, and the third. And so he swings at me, you know what I'm saying? He caught me a little bit, you know what I'm saying? But I dipped it and then hit him with the bat, boom! So now we start tussling, we tussling. Now my niggas is there, he got a few niggas with him there. Me and my niggas proceed to whoop his ass while his niggas did nothing. They sat back and watched the whole shit. Now Chaz and my nigga BJ's there, they break the shit up, you know what I'm saying? Whatever, whatever, whatever. So they breaks it up. I'm letting the nigga know, listen, you know, it is what it is. He's like, it is what it is. We had the fight, whatever. I'm like, don't come to the show tonight, nigga, because it's going to be a real problem for you come to that show tonight. So that was that incident.
Those were excerpts from Ja Rule's book, Unruly, but there was a tiny detail that Ja Rule didn't mention in the book that he mentioned in June 2003 on the XXL cover with Irv Gotti. In that article, he said that 50's chain popped and Ja Rule's chain popped, both falling on the ground. And this could lead to the incident of 50 saying that he took Ja Rule's chain. Now, why Ja Rule didn't mention that in the book, I don't know. Maybe he forgot or just didn't want people to know that his chain was actually taken. But that's the inconsistency that I noticed from Ja Rule when it comes to this story. Now let's talk about 50 Cent's side of the story from his book, From Pieces to Weight. He said, when I began talking to Ja, he started talking all crazy out of his mouth. He was putting on a performance for his homies to build up his rep. And 50 said that he's not really a street guy, so I didn't believe anything that he was saying. And 50 did confirm that Ja Rule did have a little baseball bat in his hand, and he was swinging around when he was yelling. So 50 took that as disrespectful, and he decided, hey, I'm going to swing on this guy before he does anything to me first. So 50 says that he punched him in the eye, and that Ja Rule's homies saw that the fight started. They ran towards Ja Rule. Ja Rule had 8 guys with him. They ran over and piled on 50, started beating on him, but 50 Cent ended up getting out of it and taking Ja Rule's chain. He had popped off his chain while they were fighting and told him to come get it. But by that time, the police apparently were coming and everybody dashed off. And 50 Cent was scheduled to do a show that night, like Ja Rule said, but he didn't show up, not because he was scared of Ja Rule, like Ja Rule stated, but because they didn't pay him the rest of the money, because 50 went up to a radio station and bragged that he punched Ja Rule in the eye and that he snatched his chain. And because he did that, the promoter at the concert didn't want any trouble, so he didn't end up paying the rest of the money. And this is all according to Chaz Williams. This is what Chaz Williams says as to why 50 didn't show up at the concert.
Well, what happened when we pulled up, Ja was standing outside the hotel, and he had like this little Louisville Slugger in his hand, a short Louisville Slugger. And, you know, he was standing there with, you know, a lot of Murder, Inc. people and artists and his manager, and so.
And you were cool with all the right, Murder, Inc. guys?
Yeah, I was cool with everybody. So I was like, you know, somebody said, yo, man, what's up with Philly? I said, they supposed to talk. Y'all supposed to talk. You know what I mean? So he said, all right. So when I went back to 50 and Yayo, I said to 50, I said, ain't you supposed to talk to no boy? So he said, yeah. I said, so he was acting like he didn't really want to do it, you know. And I said, well, when are you going to do it? I said, you might as well get it over with now. And so, you know, I knew he was a little reluctant about doing it, but he said, all right, you know, no fear or nothing. I just knew that he wasn't feeling any kind of peace accord, you know. But, you know, he said, okay. And when he went to pull Ja to the side, pull him, you know, away from the guys to talk to him, Ja walked over there with the bat in his hand. And, you know, 50, as they talking, you know, how people sometimes talk and they gesture with their hands or whatever, he may have gestured with the bat as he's talking. And, you know, I think, you know, he raised his voice or something. And then 50 swung on him.
Yeah.
Yeah, we went to the show that night. You know, 50 had went to radio with a Columbia rep, and we went to the show that night. Yeah, we went to the show, but we didn't know. The promoter, you know, was, you know, he had heard what happened, and basically he was trying to back down on the second half, and so we like, nah, we ain't, you know, either the second half or it ain't happening. We ain't performing, you know what I mean? So, you know, he was trying to claim that the show was ruined. Because 50 went to the radio station and basically said that he snuffed Ja. So when he mentioned what happened, the promoter's trying to say that caused him to lose money on the show. So, but we were there to do the show. But basically, when he wasn't trying to come up with that second half, we just took the first half and kept it moving.
Well, yeah, I had an altercation with Ja in Atlanta. Okay. And I hit him. But I hit him because what he was saying in conversation was telling me to hit him. He didn't realize that his body language, he was moving when he was talking to me, and you don't talk to me like that. Like I'm just conditioned for something different. But for the chain, yeah, I took the chain in that altercation.
And the radio host, who's now at V103 at Atlanta, says that Ja Rule showed up with a black eye and he had shades on at the time, further confirming that 50 Cent did black Ja Rule's eye.
He knows it! I was here when you punched Ja Rule in the face.
Oh my goodness.
Right down there. At the hotel out in front. And then he came out and they was like, Ja Rule, what happened? And
are
he was like, oh, nothing. He had his sunglasses on. And he was like, yeah, something happened.
And Bang'em Smurf, who was running with 50 Cent in the early 2000s and in the 90s, who's one of the original G-Unit members, he even confirmed that 50 Cent did black Ja Rule's eye and that Ja Rule was wearing shades while he was doing interviews. And Bang'em Smurf took this further and said that 50 Cent was wearing Ja Rule's chain on the Your Life's on the Line video shoot. In the video, he said he's wearing Ja Rule's chain and that he, Banks, and Yayo were wearing the chain at different points, and then eventually 50 Cent ended up exchanging the chain for a watch so Ja Rule could get his chain back. But the rumor that 50 Cent was wearing Ja Rule's chain in the music video for Your Life's on the Line was never confirmed by 50 Cent himself. This is something that Bang'em Smurf has only said. And Bang'em Smurf's information is sort of wishy-washy at times, so take this with a grain of salt.
Yeah, he told me about the incident. Ja did have a little bat in his hand, Sonny. You know what I mean? Ja was getting all hype out of control. So, you know, 50 is like a calm nigga. He ain't really the type of nigga to argue with you face to face. So he punched the nigga in the eye. I know Ja had a black eye because he couldn't do interviews or none of that. That's known fact. And he had the nigga chain. So how you get beat up? How you beat a nigga up? You got a black eye and you got your chain cut. Then the nigga 50 walked off like they ain't even try to get the chain back. Brought it back to the hood, he was wearing it. He also had it on in one of his music videos. He was wearing it in the murder video. Scream murder, I don't believe you. When he was still on Columbia. I even wore the nigga chain. You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you from being a rep. And I don't even like 50, so ain't no reason for me to front.
Then, according to 50, he got back to New York, talked with a few people that knew Ja Rule, explained the situation. He had the chain. Someone offered him a Movado gold watch in exchange for the chain, and that's how Ja Rule got his chain back, and 50 ended up getting a watch.
Out of that, and
okay.
They see my little boy Wayne. And you guys know us. We don't even cool with each other. He'll tell you that he saw that chain on my little boy's neck. I took it off his neck. And they end up giving me two watches in order to get the chain back.
After that incident in Atlanta, 50 Cent went back to New York. Ja Rule's back in New York. And Chaz Williams, a.k.a. Slim, tried to get 50 Cent, Supreme, and Murder, Inc. all in one room to squash the beef. However, 50 Cent never showed up because he felt that it was a setup, that if he went in that room and anything popped off, he would have ended up getting killed possibly. So he didn't show up, and because of that, Chaz Williams said that this is not resolving anything and that he wants to focus on other things. So that's when 50 and Chaz Williams, aka Slim, parted ways. He was no longer 50 Cent's manager. After that incident at Atlanta, Ja Rule started working on the compilation album for Murder, Inc. called The Murderers, and 50 was still working on his debut album at that time, Power of the Dollar, with the singles How to Rob and Your Life's on the Line out. Now fast forward to March 24th, 2000, and 50 Cent and Ja Rule meet up again in person, and this time it's in New York at a recording studio called The Hit Factory. Now, of course, there's two sides to this story, like all these other stories. There's 50 Cent's side with his team, and then there's Ja Rule's side with his team. And we're first going to start it out with 50 Cent's side. Now, there's a few things that 50 Cent has said that isn't consistent from his previous statements about the situation at The Hit Factory, but that's also the case with Ja Rule. He has some statements that don't coincide with his previous statements, and I'm going to be talking about those as well. In 50 Cent's book, From Pieces to Weight, he details the incident at the Hit Factory, but he misses a few things in the book. I guess he decided either to not add him in or that he didn't want people suing him for having their names mentioned in the book. So 50 starts it out by saying, I was recording at the Hit Factory in Manhattan, and Ja Rule was recording in a separate studio. I guess he was still upset about me laying a pounding on him in Atlanta because he and his crew rushed into my studio while I was recording. Someone snuck in and turned out the lights, and a fight broke out. The fight was so quick, I didn't even know what happened. They ran in, threw some sucker punches, and ran out. I wasn't sure what was going on, so I got out and hopped in a cab and went home. When I was in the back seat of the taxi, I realized that I was bleeding from my gut. I figured that I must have bumped into a piece of recording equipment or something. When I got home, my grandmother told me that she had heard that I was stabbed in a studio. I lifted up my shirt to show her the nick, and she cleaned it off with peroxide. And then 50 Cent explains why the next day he ended up going to the hospital. He said, the only reason I even went to the hospital was because the next morning my grandmother wanted me to make sure the cut wasn't infected. It had stopped bleeding, but she wanted me to double check, so I did. When I got to the hospital, they put in 3 stitches, prescribed some antibiotics, and sent me home. Now, the inconsistencies are this. In an XXL interview in September 2001, 50 Cent said that he did not reach for a gun at all. But in a 2007 interview, 50 Cent said that he wished he had his gun at that time. He was trying to reach his gun, which was in the other room, but ultimately he couldn't. That's the only inconsistencies that I see in this story. 50 also mentions that he got stabbed on his side. Tony Yayo got stabbed in the hand, and the DJ that was at the studio at that time got stabbed somewhere in the area between the shoulder and the chest.
You know what's crazy is they were so scared, they was terrifying me after that Hit Factor.
Yeah.
They always some suckers, B. Let me tell you, it came, the door was super narrow, right? We in the hallway upstairs in Hit Factory, them little rooms they got upstairs.
Yeah.
It's super narrow, right? They came,
was dumb small room,
and closed the door. The door that they was in my jacket is in their room. Look, there's 2 doors right here, right? My jacket is in this room. The hallway's narrow enough for us to walk through. That's it. They come close this door. They in there. They just let them close the door. My gun is in the jacket in that room. So we got to go through the scrapping on this side. The boy gets stabbed in the chest.
Yeah.
The DJ. The whole situation was bugged out, but they got my fucking pistol in the other room. Sitting there, I'm knocking the door after these niggas done ran down. I can't even get my pistol. I want to shoot a nigga going down the steps.
If that pistol was in that
room, it would've been all right if I did that. It would've been self-defense still. Because all that many people came in there, whole different thing.
If that pistol was in that
changed
room,
everything.
Oh my shit.
Better I'd have let the swear me off in there with a bunch of niggas too. Bang, niggas been back. 2 niggas been hit by 1 bullet. Then I didn't even go to the hospital. The little scratch I had only was with 3 stitches.
Yeah, you're back.
I didn't go to her. I went home. And I'm in the radio hearing I went to the hospital. So they had me. I was like, all right. That's the end of this.
I left with 2 scratches.
The day after.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Right there and right there. 2 scratches. That's all bitch-ass niggas could do. You know what I mean?
They always make it bigger than it is.
Now let's talk about Ja Rule's side of the story. And Ja Rule's side of the story has multiple people speaking on the incident. That was from his team, from Chris Gotti to Irv Gotti to Black Child from Murder, Inc. at that time. They all spoke on the incident and gave their own story about the incident. This is how Ja Rule explains the incident on his book, Unruly. He says, on March 20th, I got a call from a friend who happened to be hanging out at the Hit Factory studio in New York City. Guess who's in the studio tonight? She asked. I thanked her for the tip. I knew what I had to do. My man Merc, he had broken his foot. I took his crutch to use it as a weapon. I was headed upstairs because I happened to be at the Hit Factory that night too. My crew followed me. We paid 50 Cent a visit. He was still talking, rhyming, and talking too much shit with his silly mouth. The incident in Atlanta showed me that the beef had just begun. I was getting mad. Not knowing which studio suit 50 was in, we went from door to door until we found him. I opened the door and 50 was in a small recording studio. He looked at me like he had seen a ghost. He said, yo, let's talk. You've been talking enough. Bam, I pushed my way into the studio. I hit him with the crutch. We proceeded to whip his ass. I was putting in work. 50 was crunched in a corner. I slammed the big Tannoy speaker down on him. While he's getting his ass beat, I heard him say, get the gun. Get your gun, I replied. At that moment, Black started poking people with a knife and 50 got stabbed. After blood was shed, we got up out of there. Now here's where the inconsistencies in this story come. Chris Gotti, who was interviewed about this incident, who's Irv Gotti's brother, he said that Ja Rule was on crutches and that his leg was the one that was broken. In Ja Rule's book, he said his friend's leg was the one that was broken and that he grabbed his friend's crutches and started beating 50 with them. But Chris says Ja Rule had nothing to do with the incident. Ja Rule was just in the same building, but Chris Gotti, Irv Gotti, and Black Child were the ones that went and beat up 50 Cent in the studio.
in the studio. We had the big room, the number one room is in the Hit Factory, huge room. And Rule's like, he's here. He's here. Rule had crutches. He was on MTV. I think he did something on jet skis and messed his ankle up. So he had crutches. His ankles messed up. And he's like, who's here? He's like, 50. He's here. He's in the building.
Okay, and Ja was on crutches. He wasn't involved.
Yeah, Ja didn't get arrested.
Chris Gotti also said that he came there late with Irv Gotti. And right when he came in the building, Ja Rule was already furious about 50 Cent being in the same building with him, and that he was yelling, where's 50, let's go get him. And Irv Gotti was like, just ignore that. And then they were arguing back and forth, and eventually Irv Gotti said, fuck it, let's go get 50. They were looking for him in the studio, and that's when the fight started to happen. So apparently Ja Rule had nothing to do with the incident. The way Ja Rule explained the story in his book, it seems like he was the main person, you know, that went at 50. Black Child's side of the story is essentially the same, but Black Child says that he bumped into the lights and that he didn't turn them off. He just so happened to bump into the lights, and that he was throwing speakers at 50 and stabbed 50 because he heard that 50 was trying to reach for his gun. And in order to protect himself and his crew members, he decided to stab 50 Cent and various other people.
We seen them, they seen us, it popped off, and one of them started reaching for a gun. Yeah, I stabbed him, you know what I mean? But he was reaching for his gun and I poked him straight up and down.
OG Bimmy, who's from the Supreme Team, was also there that night, and the way he details it was that Praz from the Fugees came in the studio that Ja Rule was in, and he called him out and said that 50 Cent is in the studio upstairs somewhere and that you guys should go see him. He called him out in front of everybody in the studio because in that session there were about 40-50 people from Murder, Inc. So when you get called out like that, you can't, you know, not do anything about your enemy. You know, you're going to go up there, and regardless, you're going to have to fight or do something, because if you don't do anything, it's going to make you look like a sucker. So he had to do something. Praz from the Fugees, according to OG Bimmy, is the one who started it.
Matter of fact, I was in the Hit Factory, me and Corey Rooney.
Okay.
We was in the Hit Factory when it first went down, and they was upstairs. He was upstairs working with Tony Pope.
Yeah.
And I was downstairs, and then I was going to check them, whatever, when they came down. So I go check Ja Rule and Irv and them. They had a session in
the right, in the same joint, yeah. Same
joint. So I go in their room. So I'm sitting on the board, by the board, and Praz come in from the Fugees. He come in.
Okay.
So Praz, like, they start talking into my 50, whatever. And the Praz said, nigga, upstairs right now. So he threw Ja on the spot in front of everybody, you know, niggas, bitches. So he had no choice but to, like, oh, let's go up and get him.
Yeah.
Then he had to do
that. Yeah, he had to.
Then 50, after the incident, went downstairs and went across the street to the Source magazine, which at the time was owned by Benzino. He asked at the front door if he could use their car service to get home after the stabbing, and Benzino details this in his Breakfast Club interview.
But when that happened with 50, I hadn't known Ja Rule yet.
Mm-hmm.
And I was down with the Made Men and Sony at the time.
Talking about when they beat up 50 in the studio.
When that situation happened. So 50, you know, one of the guys at the Made Men was outside smoking a cigarette and stuff. So 50 had came and seen him, and that's when he brought him in. That was the first time I met him, and he had showed me he had been cut. You know what I'm saying? And he was telling me the story. So, you know, we had a car service at that time.
He was leaking at the time.
A little bit, you know what I'm saying? So I called him a car service, you know, the Atlantic car service we had with the Source, and I guess it took him to Bellevue.
Now let's talk about the most interesting thing after this Hit Factory incident, and that's the restraining order that allegedly 50 Cent filed for. The first thing about this restraining order is the fact that it is real. This is not a fake restraining order at all. In late 2002, approximately 2 years, Irv Gotti and Ja Rule went to Hot 97 and exposed 50 Cent for allegedly filing for a restraining order after the incident at the Hit Factory.
And what I'm holding in my hand, I'm going to leave with you, man, is a order of protection.
Uh-oh.
An order of protection for Irving Lorenzo to stay away from Curtis Jackson. That's 50, y'all.
Ooh.
A.K.A. 5-0. A.K.A. 5-0. A.K.A. informant. A.K.A. I'm telling.
And in an XXL interview on February 2003, 50 Cent said that this was just a publicity stunt for Irv Gotti and Ja Rule to discredit 50 Cent's street credibility, because he said they waited nearly 2 years to finally reveal this restraining order. And 50 said in the interview that this restraining order was in fact fake. Now, why 50 Cent said that it was fake at that time, knowing that people can just search up the information, I don't know why. But now, in more recent interviews, he's confirmed that it is real, but that someone else filed for it. Now, let's talk about who exactly filed for the restraining order. Irv Gotti and Ja Rule say that it was 50 Cent that called the police and told them about the incident, and then when they got arrested, the court issued a restraining order. 50 Cent, however, denies this. He says that the DJ got hurt, and the DJ was someone that didn't have a lot of money. When he got stabbed, he saw that Ja Rule was a big star at that time because he had released his debut album already. It went platinum. He was selling records. He had some songs on the radio. So he saw this as a come up after he got stabbed. He was like, fuck it, I'm going to try to get some money out of this. So I'm going to call the police, report it, and hopefully get these guys in jail and have them pay for my bills and hopefully sue them in the future.
Who, at this time, I ain't got no money. I'm not paying them. How am I supposed to control what he does after that? He's looking at it like it's payday. Oh, they're going to pay for this.
Yeah.
They feeling like I'm supposed, like I'm doing it.
Yeah, you got to do what you got
to
do.
Like, I'm telling them to do that. So you know how the old heads deal with anything. You know what I mean? So that's why I go down when we go down. But.
Now, this story makes sense to me because if I was a DJ in that situation, I would do the same thing. Because I have nothing to do with these guys. 50 and Ja Rule's problems should not spill over to me. I should not get stabbed for something that I had nothing to do with. And I would see that as a come up myself easily. I would have ended up calling the police and suing because this is an incident that has nothing to do with me. I'm not involved in the streets. I'm sure that DJ wasn't involved in the streets. He was just there to engineer and produce and do his work as a DJ. Now, what further confirms that Ja Rule had nothing to do with this Hit Factory incident, like he says in his book, is that Blackchild, Chris Gotti, and Irv Gotti were the ones that were arrested, and Ja Rule ultimately did not end up getting arrested. So when the DJ allegedly called the police, he only mentioned Irv Gotti, Chris Gotti, and Blackchild for Murder, Inc. He did mention 50, Lloyd Banks, Tony Yayo, and Bangham Smurf. For those that don't know, it is New York law to have an order of protection filed after an incident is reported like this to prevent further incidents. On the New York County District Attorney's Office website, it says an order of protection is a document issued by the court that forbids an individual from engaging in certain behavior. So this is a document that is issued by the court regardless of anyone requesting it or not. After it gets reported by someone to the police, if people get arrested, those people that were the victims instantly have an order of protection for them to prevent further things like this happening. And that makes sense. They don't want this thing happening again. So if somebody called the police and made sure to report this, they knew about the incident, so they filed the order of protection. The court did itself, nobody individually. So with that being said, the DJ must have called the police and told the police exactly who was there and who was involved, because that's how they ended up arresting Chris Gotti, Irv Gotti, and Blackchild, and that's how they ended up defending and putting an order of protection for 50, Yayo, Banks, and Bangham Smurf, and so on and so forth. Chris Gotti says they didn't end up getting convicted because 50 Cent did not show up in court to pursue the order of protection, which further confirms that 50 did not want this order of protection. If he doesn't show up in court to pursue it more, that means that 50 wasn't the one that requested this. It was the DJ or somebody else that was involved in the incident. Chris Gotti then goes on to say that he ended up paying $250,000 worth of hospital fees after that incident at the Hit Factory.
Me and Irv got arrested.
What were you charged with?
I don't remember all the charges. Honestly, I don't remember all the charges.
But you didn't end up getting convicted or anything else?
No, like that. I got thrown away.
Why?
Because he didn't show up.
Oh, he didn't show up to court.
You got to do it. You got to go through the motions. We paid doctor bills.
How much was it? Do you remember?
Yeah, about $50,000 a head.
$50,000
each.
You had to pay $50,000
to each of the people because there's multiple people that got stabbed and beat up that day.
Okay, so you guys had to cough up $100,000?
More than that.
$200,000?
It's probably about $250,000.
$250,000.
Yeah.
And that was so it wouldn't go to court, essentially?
Well, it was paying their doctor bills, and then a court was just separate because, again, you get arrested for everything, and then you got to have someone that's saying you did it. if no one shows up to say that. But then that's business, right? He didn't put Ja Rule on the order protection. He just put me and Irv on the order protection.
Oh.
Ja wasn't on the order protection. It was me and Irv.
After that, in April of 2000, 50 Cent decided to release a song called Ghetto Quran. And this song caused a lot of controversy amongst the lyrics that he was spitting on this song. Supreme wasn't a fan of this song, and he felt like 50 Cent was dry snitching on the things that he was doing in the streets and amongst all the other Queens members.
Yo, when you hear talk of the South Side, you hear talk of the team. See niggas fear Prince and respected Prince. For all you slow motherfuckers, I'ma break it down iller. Supreme was the businessman and Prince was the killer.
In the Vibe July 2006 magazine, Supreme was interviewed, and Supreme says he abandoned peacemaking efforts when he realized that 50 Cent was an agent provocateur, a billing 50 would live up to in the song Ghetto Quran, which vividly chronicled the South Jamaica crack trade. It was factual, Supreme says. He said Supreme was the businessman and Prince was the killer, but he still feels 50 shouldn't have aired dirty laundry. When we was coming up, there was a code of conduct, Supreme explains. You don't speak about dudes who may still be in the streets. Based off that excerpt from that article, it's clear that Supreme was upset that 50 Cent even mentioned him in the song Ghetto Quran. But in 50 Cent's eyes, he was just paying homage to all the Queens legends in the streets. In the XXL article from September 2006, 50 Cent said the Ghetto Quran didn't make any reference to anybody who was actively doing something at that time. It was all past shit. I'm just saluting guys.
As far as the Quran was concerned, even when the Quran came out, everybody that was on the record was cool with the record. They knew what it was about. It was like Corey D writing a dedication rhyme. You know what I'm saying? In the neighborhood at that point. And this is all about previous activity. It's not nothing about things that they could actually be convicted for or, you know, tried on in this situation at that point.
However, like I said, Supreme felt a different way. He felt like he was airing out dirty laundry because he was still in the streets. He hadn't made it yet, and he felt like since he was saying that, the cops would get on Supreme a lot more. Ja Rule, even in his book Unruly, decided to detail the time when 50 Cent dropped Ghetto Quran. He said, "When I heard about Ghetto Quran, I couldn't believe the detail in which he snitched on Preem. Even I took that shit personally. The underground started to talk about 50 negatively. Motherfuckers realized that he should be avoided at all costs. The word was out. 50 is a snitch. Ghetto Quran was to have serious repercussions. 50 Cent was in danger. When Preem heard about Ghetto Quran, the message was sent to every record producer and DJ throughout America not to play 50's shit and not to even fuck with him. The streets obeyed. At one point, 50 Cent couldn't even find a record studio anywhere that would let him record in their facility." Fast forward to May 23rd, 2000. 50 Cent is leaving his grandma's house sometime in the afternoon. He gets in the back seat of his friend's car and ends up getting shot 9 times. In the book From Pieces to Weight, 50 Cent details that day varied vividly. He says the driver was waiting for me out in front of the car with his girlfriend. He didn't see anything out of the ordinary. I walked outside of the house, looked both ways, and hopped in. They proceeded to have a conversation about a chain. 50 Cent then decided to go back in his house, put on a diamond cross, and decided to get some hardware in case anyone was going to try and rob him of his chain while he was out and about. He said, "I grabbed a jacket to carry the pistols. I pulled from the backyard and made a light jog to the car with the guns in the jacket. The jacket in my arm, the chain in my hand. This time I didn't look both ways. Another car eased up the block and stopped, but it didn't register at that time. I slid into the back seat. I felt someone coming over my shoulder but saw no one there. The other car resumed rolling. When I handed the chain to the driver, the shooter was sneaking up on my left side. I want to believe that I saw it coming at that point, but if I had seen it coming, then I wouldn't have gotten shot, would I? The shooter was on me, emptying bullets. I jumped. I felt my legs on fire and fell back down. The shooter stuck his hand deeper in the window, still bucking. I reached for the jacket in my lap. I pointed the pistol at the shooter, but the gun wasn't cocked. There was nothing in the chamber. A bullet tore into my face and my mouth exploded. Another slug blew up my hand before the driver finally pulled off." After the shooting, 50 Cent was immediately rushed to the hospital by his friend and underwent surgery to get the bullets removed. While 50 Cent was in the hospital, the word got out in Queens that 50 Cent got shot, and a lot of people were expecting him to die, and a lot of questions were being asked in the streets as to why 50 Cent got shot and who was the one that shot him. The first suspect in this 50 Cent shooting is the one that 50 Cent himself said shot him, and his name is Darrell Hamo Bomb. Hamo is short for homicide, and he was a stick-up kid from Brooklyn. Hamo was also someone that was a close friend of Mike Tyson and also a former bodyguard of Mike Tyson. Hamo even lived in Mike Tyson's mansion when he shot 50 Cent, and this is the same mansion that 50 Cent later purchased when Mike Tyson went bankrupt. Like 50 Cent highlights in the song Many Men, Hamo eventually, 3 weeks later, ended up getting killed on June 10th, 2000 for allegedly pressuring a Cash Money Brothers member, Edward Taz Cookie, to sell drugs for him. Cash Money Brothers was a clique in Brooklyn that pushed a lot of weights and drugs. And according to the police, the person that pulled the trigger was Eric Ebay Moore and Damian World Hardy. Both of these guys were a Cash Money clique member as well in New York. However, 50 Cent had nothing to do with these guys getting killed. When 50 Cent was shot, he was simply in the hospital recovering, and he did not order a hit on anybody. When Mike Tyson learned that Hamo ended up getting killed, he dedicated his fight against Lou Sarvez to him, and he said, "I love you with all my heart." And allegedly, Mike Tyson put a $50,000 hit on any member of the Cash Money clique that had to do with Hamo getting killed.
"I dedicate this fight to my brother, Darrell Bomb, who died. I'll be there to see you. I love you with all my heart."
Some stunning testimony from a government witness who claims former heavyweight champion boxer Mike Tyson put up $50,000 for a proposed hit on gang members. The witness, who was testifying at a gang turf war trial, says Tyson, a native New Yorker, wanted retaliation after his close friend and former bodyguard was killed back in 2000. The alleged contract was never carried out. Tyson and his attorney have not commented on this testimony.
Damian World Hardy, the guy who allegedly killed Hamo or had a part in killing Hamo, was the ex-boyfriend of Lil' Kim. And when 50 Cent in 2003 went to Hot 97 and said that he wrote Lil' Kim's hit and that he has no respect for Lil' Kim, and shortly after that interview, Damian tried shooting and killing 50 Cent outside of a hotel. And currently, Damian World Hardy has a life sentence for 6 murders that he's been involved in, and one of them is for Darrell Hamo Bomb, the same guy that allegedly shot 50 Cent. Now, if what 50 Cent is saying is right, why would Hamo shoot 50 Cent? What would be his motive? The person that allegedly paid Hamo to kill 50 Cent was Kenneth McGriff, aka Supreme. And the reason for ordering this hit is various things. Supreme was, of course, upset that 50 Cent aired out his dirty laundry on the Ghetto Quran song. Supreme was also upset that 50 Cent would continually go at Ja Rule, Irv Gotti, and the rest of the Murder, Inc. when Supreme had various meetings with 50 Cent saying, "Do not go at them, they're my food," meaning they're my way in the industry and they're what's making me money. And of course, as you can tell, 50 Cent never listened to Supreme and did what he wanted to do, and that's the reason why allegedly Supreme ordered the hit. In 1999, when 50 Cent was doing all these crazy things and going at Ja Rule, he had an OG behind him by the name of Chaz Slim Williams, who's been mentioned in this video various times. Chaz is very well respected in Queens, so when Chaz was managing 50 Cent, 50 Cent had an OG behind him. But when Chaz left, that's when it was open season on 50 Cent, because 50 Cent didn't have an OG backing him. And this is highlighted in the book, The Supreme Team, The Birth of Crack and Hip Hop. In the book, it says, when Chaz, aka Slim, cut 50 loose, he was condemned to death. With no G to protect him, he was fair game. The wolves controlled and influenced the artists in the hip-hop industry, and any viable artist needed an OG's protection. 50 didn't have anyone backing him. He became a target to anyone in the streets marked for death. 50 Cent also highlighted this in his Many Men song, mentioning Slim and how he switched sides on him and let people ride on him, meaning letting people have an open season on him and not making sure that he's okay.
"Slim switched sides on me, let niggas ride on me. I thought he was cool, but you want me to die, homie, homie."
in the XXL September 2006 article, he highlights this and says that Chaz did not call for him after he got shot. He didn't even check up on him to see if he's okay. He said, after I got shot up, I called my grandmother's house. I say, anybody call me there? She said, no. I said, Ma, you sure nobody called there for me? The old man didn't call there for me. Mind you, these guys is old. They're like 47 fucking years old. And I'm like, an old man didn't call there for me? She goes, no. So in my head, if Chaz, aka Slim, didn't know exactly what the fuck happened before it happened, then he knew already. So in 50's eyes, Chaz, aka Slim, already knew there was a hit out on 50 Cent. But Chaz, in an interview, said that he did not call about 50 or visit him in the hospital because he had a lot of police issues in the past and he didn't want any attraction from the police. Regardless of Chaz's explanation as to why he didn't visit 50 Cent, to 50 that didn't matter at all because Chaz was always on the fence and never on 50's side in 50's eyes, and because of that he was never cool with him ever again. Now here's a surprise twist. In the book The Supreme Team, The Birth of Crack and Hip Hop, 50 said that he made up the scenario about Hamo being gunned down to prove to Supreme he wasn't a snitch. In 2002, Supreme was arrested pending murder charges with rival gangsters E Moneybags and Troy Singleton, and many men didn't get released until February 2003 when the album came out. And 50 Cent knew that when many men got released, the police would investigate that song and use it as evidence against Supreme. Had 50 Cent mentioned the actual shooter who was under the Supreme team, Supreme would have easily gotten life immediately and 50 Cent would have been labeled a snitch. So 50 decided to mention someone from Brooklyn to deter the police so that they wouldn't go hard in investigating the shooting that happened with 50 Cent. Regardless of that, when the feds locked up Supreme, they didn't stop at nothing to get Supreme, and they wanted to charge Supreme with the attempted murder of 50 Cent. So with the people that were locked up with Supreme, that were under the Supreme team, they offered to lower their sentences if they testified against Supreme. And unfortunately for Supreme, that's exactly what happened. A guy by the name of John Reagan, who was a former partner with Supreme in the Picture Perfect Film Company, took a stand against Supreme to testify about his knowledge of Supreme's involvement in the 50 Cent shooting. Reagan at that time was facing 19 years in jail for a credit card and ecstasy ring. He was hoping that with his testimony in the case, his sentence will get reduced to time served. John Reagan began to give his account of the notorious incident. Reagan explained how Preem met with 50 face to face and warned him to stop talking about Ja and Murder, Inc. The prosecutor then asked Reagan if he knew who shot 50 Cent. He replied, yes, son, in reference to the head of security at Murder, Inc., Robert Son Leones. Reagan claims that he was part of Son's alibi, meeting Supreme, Son, and the Supreme Team affiliate God B at a mall shortly after the shooting took place. He also claims to have witnessed Son wash the gun residue off his hands with rubbing alcohol. In the book, The Supreme Team, The Birth of Crack and Hip Hop, this gets into more detail as to what Reagan witnessed. In the book, it says Supreme and the Murder, Inc. crew were ecstatic. Reportedly, a message from one of Murder, Inc.'s pagers that was sent shortly after 50 was shot said, "Fuck half a dollar, me and my guys kill for fun." Irv Gotti also sent a flurry of messages, allegedly within 30 minutes of the shooting, asking how many times 50 was shot and if he was killed. Supreme, however, hasn't been charged with the attempted murder of 50 Cent. Supreme, however, has been charged of murdering various other people. However, Supreme was never the one that would shoot the trigger. He would be the one that would drop off the money to a hitman to shoot the person that he wanted killed. After the shooting, Columbia Records dropped 50 Cent. 50 Cent says that they got scared, and to him, getting shot wasn't as bad as getting dropped. He spent 13 days in the hospital and eventually got out. 50 Cent also didn't know who he could trust after he got shot. That's why all the people that were working around him at the time were in-house or people related to 50 Cent. And while 50 Cent was recovering and learning how to walk, Ja Rule, on the other hand, was on top of the world. In 2000, Ja Rule released his second album, Rule 336. This album went on to spawn various hits and went on to go 3x platinum. The songs Between Me and You are on the Billboard Hot 100 in the top 10. Put It On Me was in the top 10. So Ja Rule was just ruling the charts and ruling the record sales. That is it for part one of 50 Cent versus Ja Rule. who really won. Thank you for watching. I want to give a big shout out to G-Unit News Daily. They gave me exclusive 50 Cent photos to use in this video. Go ahead and follow them on Instagram. They'll keep you up to date with anything 50 Cent/G-Unit related. I also just recently started a Patreon, so if you want to help and support me through all these things that I'm doing on my YouTube, a lot of these videos take a lot of time for me to do, and YouTube has demonetized a lot of my content. Sometimes I never get remonetized for some of the videos that I do. So if you can support me on Patreon, I'd really, really appreciate it. Doesn't matter whether it's $2, $3, $4, whatever it is. If you can do that, I'd really appreciate it. If you can't, then just simply like, share, comment, all of that. Share this video with everyone you know that loves hip hop, that loves documentaries. Share it all over the place. That's another way that you can support me. And definitely, definitely subscribe. Follow me on Twitter and on Instagram @QuakeGW. Like us on Facebook, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace.